The Philippine Stock Exchange kicks off trading at 59.25. Joining us today for his take on the markets, Victor Limlingan of Regina Capital. Hi,
Alvin. Hi, Michelle. Always a pleasure.
Okay, so at this moment, at this level, we're at what, 5,900? Mm-hmm. Seeing how the PSEI has done compared to peers in Asia and the rest of the world, are you still positive on Philippine assets?
Yes, for the medium term, no? Mm-hmm. In the short term, there's been a lot of bad news. Recoveries haven't been as fast as maybe what we would have liked. And that's causing downward pressure on the PSE, at least keeping it within this range. But that can be a good thing because now you have the opportunity to buy value. You just won't realize it in the short term, but maybe the medium term.
Mm-hmm. And by medium term, how long? What's the time horizon we're talking about?
Realistically, we're thinking maybe 2022, 2023. 2021, we're not yet quite sure, but we do know there'll be election spending come 2022. So that should stir things up.
Mm-hmm. We have this just in, the PSEI now trading higher by a third of 1%, 18 points, 59.43. Mm-hmm. Alvin, very quickly, what are investors squarely focused on today?
Well, I guess we should make the distinction which investors now. Those with the opportunity to invest in multiple markets, not just our own, are more selective on their themes. And that's why you might see an outflow of foreign investors because they're more after tech stocks and those which have a greater likelihood of surviving this economy. Mm-hmm. Now, domestically, the Philippines is more traditional, things that are affected by this, such as real estate and tourism. And so that's why foreign investors are maybe looking elsewhere. But local investors who perhaps don't have these options or not as flexible are really looking for value plays over here. And I think we'll get into this, but we have a few picks for you.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned foreign funds. They have been selling out of the Philippine market for 24 straight days. So whatever bump up we're seeing, it's all thanks to the locals, the domestic investors. Clearly, foreign money is going elsewhere. And China could be one destination because, you know, China's economy is essentially endorsed by the IMF as the only one to see output levels higher this year than in 2019, and whose stock market, by the way, recently topped $10 trillion the first time since 2015. How much longer do you think is this foreign fund bleeding going to last for Philippines?
It's very hard to give an exact date, but I will give you a proxy. What we're looking closely at is the Converge IPO. If you see strong foreign demand in that IPO because locals have not been as receptive, then maybe that's the signal. So that may be our bellwether. At least that's our nearest bellwether. Looking ahead, maybe you can look at other indicators such as GDP for the third quarter.
Okay. Speaking of the proxy, Converge ICT saying that they did see oversubscription already from the foreign side.
Exactly.
So it's not, you know, driving a lot of interest among the locals? Not so much?
Well, as a local investor, you can't but help compare it to its local peer groups now.
Okay.
It's 7.5 times the PE of its peer groups. And while I understand their argument that, you know, they want to fund growth in the Visayas and Mindanao, let's face it, 60 to 70% of the GDP is in Luzon. So I don't know how much growth you're going for in those areas. And presumably the capex will be greater given its less density.
Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go over some interesting corporate stories. Mm-hmm. ICTSI Ecuador unit invests $18 million for Guayaquil Port. This is in Ecuador. Mm-hmm. ICTSI is a big trade play. And now that, you know, economies are slowing, what do you think? Is this a good bet today or good to buy today and profit from tomorrow?
Well, at these prices, maybe we just watch it first. I mean, fundamentally, the company is fantastic. No, it has a strong balance sheet. It's very well diversified. Unfortunately, just about every other investor knows that. So you won't find deep value at this point. But it's something you should watch. And if the opportunity presents itself, certainly pick up some shares.
Okay. Also, a lot of companies, you know, forming the beeline to raise funds. SMC Global Power supposedly got like three times its original bond offer. They got over $1.2 billion orders for a $400 million mm-hmm. bond. 8990 Holdings, the low-cost developer of Deca Homes, raising $1.3 billion from corporate notes to help pay down their debts. And Del Monte also getting the SEC nod for up to $7.5 billion in bond registration. Are you starting to worry that all of these corporates are just taking on essentially debt?
Well, no, because debt is essentially free at this point. I mean, it's actually a no-brainer for you to borrow. If you can borrow at the rates of a San Miguel, and that's a big if, no? If you can borrow at the rates of an 8990, it's a no-brainer because in the next year or so, there's going to be some deep discounts. And with essentially, well, almost free money, you know, you have the firepower to take it. So anyone who can borrow at these rates should.
Mm-hmm. And of course, wanted to go over some interesting stories here from abroad. IKEA. By the way, before we go to IKEA, something related. Double Dragon has deferred its REIT IPO to next year.
Yes. Well, Double Dragon's. Yeah. Well, I think it's the smart move, no? Mm-hmm. We all know that Pogo is maybe not the sunrise industry that it once was, mm-hmm. and the tenant base of Double Dragon seems highly skewed in that regard. So it might not be the best timing right now. Mm-hmm. You may want to wait a little while till the situation is clear. Mm-hmm. It's more to do with the tax breaks.
Okay.
And then do your REIT then. Maybe you can get a better price then.
Okay. For foreign news, IKEA, the world's mm-hmm. biggest furniture business, is planning a secondhand furniture business. They're going to be launching this by next month. The scheme is to buy back your unwanted old furniture and in exchange give you vouchers worth up to 50% of its original price to be spent, of course, at its store. So it's essentially a closed-loop system. IKEA earlier also saying that it will open a record 50 stores in the coming year, hopefully including the stalled Manila store. Home furnishings, you know, we all have so much time at home. Are you also still betting big on this?
Well, there are not that many proxies for that, mm-hmm. maybe all home. But I think the IKEA story was more a bellwether of the time. You know, IKEA is used, mm-hmm. you know, is known for its value furniture. Mm-hmm. So for it to be entering the secondhand furniture business speaks to global consumption. I think that's more of the insight I got from that story. But having said that, now's mm-hmm. the time to be looking for value wherever you can find it.
Okay. Finally, we've come to the most exciting part of this conversation, the blind item. Alvin, mm-hmm. stock that you're monitoring closely. Don't tell us what, just describe. So what do you have for us today?
Okay, as I was saying earlier, now's the time to look for value wherever you may find it. And this company, if I can say it, it's a holding company.
Okay.
And it has a subsidiary, which you know, is doing very well. Now, you can essentially buy that same subsidiary for 25 to 30% off its market price, depending on where the stock price is. So again, why wouldn't you? We all know there's a conglomerate discount, but now that we're looking for value, why wouldn't you want to look at this, no? When you're essentially getting the same great company at 25% off.
Okay, we're just going to have to guess which stock this is. I'm pretty sure the viewers have an idea. Alvin, thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Anytime, Mimi. Thank you.
Thank you.